Obviously, there's a lot to sort of talk about. We've had a great response to this invitation, sort of to this webinar. I think we had 74 people who registered. So I'd imagine we'll be having sort of more come on sort of in the next 10 minutes or so. Please have a look down the left bottom left hand corner of your screen, and there's an opportunity for you to be able to ask questions. So if you can write them down rather than talk, and we have a lot of people causing all sorts of mass confusion, if you could just down in the bottom left-hand corner type in any questions that you may have. And I've got Belinda here with me, who's going to be making a list of the questions, and after about 15 or 20 minutes or so, after we run through this basic session, we'll start to answer your questions. And please feel free to ask anything sort of relevant to what we're talking about in the slides that you're going to see. And similarly, if there's anything else that you'd like to discuss, please feel free to chat with me and to write them down. Conversely, for those of you who are going to be attending the Marketing Dentistry series in coming up later this year in August, please feel free to come and talk to me about some of those things in detail later in the year. Well, let's start off with the first slide. We sort of see here this our dental future is shrouded with uncertainty. Looks like an English station, and you can see lots of steam, and obviously you can't sort of see too far ahead. And I think that in all the years since I graduated, which was way back in 1978 as a 22-year-old, I don't think that I've ever seen dentistry in such an unusual and unpredictable state. I think globally, it's interesting. We sort of see what's just transpired in the UK, I don't think that's really going to have too much impact there. And obviously, the election is going to impact what happens in Australia. And although, if you look today, the ADA sent out a bulletin with some of the so-called policies of both parties. As far as dentistry is concerned, and if you do happen to have a look at that, you'll notice that the parties, other than the CDBS, are generally sitting on the fence very much, as they always do. So I don't think you can draw any sort of hard and fast conclusions over any of the policies that our parties are talking about. Nick Xenophon, of course, is out there again, which is great. He's been a great advocate and help for us, and you know, he stirs things up in the Senate. And he's talking about now with the behaviour of the health insurance firms and misuse of power and some anti-competitive behaviour. So I think Nick has done a lot for dentistry over the years, I'm glad that at least, even if he's not elected, he certainly raises the ire and awareness of some of the issues that perhaps a lot of us wouldn't tackle. As I said, I applaud his efforts very, very, very much. But we'll see what happens. I'm an advocate. I think that the Libs will be returned. And I think that Malcolm is looking to sort of save some money and obviously replace the CDBS with his new child and adult public scheme. Will this affect many of you in private practice? Probably not too much at all. There's some talk about moving some of the public sector work into the private sector once again. But again, I would like to see the detail on that before anything happens in the future. I wouldn't be building a practice certainly based on a CDBS scheme again after the debacle that sort of occurred previously. Anyway, look, let's talk about where the Australian dental practices and the state of the union. First of all, I want to go back to the sort of fundamentals, and I would like you to stop and consider some basic economics, because a lot of the sort of things that are happening at the moment are related to macroeconomic factors. If you have a look at here, this slide, now this is when you do some basic economics. This is a supply and demand graph. So this is something which is obviously fairly simple, but nevertheless, this is very, very significant. And I don't think a lot of dentists understand or realise just how significant this is in dentistry in Australia today. You see the demand curve in the red and the supply curve in the blue, and where they intersect is equilibrium. Okay, the equilibrium on the left end reflects as far as price is concerned and quantity down the bottom. Now, that's just the basic supply and demand curve. But I just want you to consider how this works in your practice and how this works in dentistry in Australia. When we move on to the next slide here, we have a look at a few things that are actually happening. We're going to look at what actually happens when demand changes, and we're also going to look what happens when supply changes, and the impact when both occur at the same time. Now, you mightn't have had a look at your practices and from this perspective before, but I can assure you these forces are strongly at work at the moment, and even more so in the next few years. So let's look at demand here. And first of all, the demand for services, the demand for dentistry in Australia. What's actually happening? Are we actually seeing an increase in demand? Is it static, or is it actually going backwards? Now, a lot of you who are in different, and I notice a lot of people sort of on here from different areas, you'll notice that sort of this may not be one particular blanket covering every dentist or dental practice in the country. Certainly here, we're here in Double Bay, we sort of have a different cohort to what might be in the city of Sydney, or the inner west, or the outer west, or rural or regional areas. But nevertheless, the problem that we sort of see, that what we believe for traditional forms of dentistry, and when I say traditional forms of dentistry, I'm not talking about restorative elements in particular, the demand, if anything, is shrinking. Now, the number, what factors actually affect demand? And stop and think about that into your practice. What actually factors do affect it? So let's have a little look at this. We go to the next slide. And what actually happens? What are the most significant factors? Well, first of all, the population and the population structure. And stop and think for a moment about your own practice and think, what is the average age in your practice? Is it a young demographic? Is it a middle age? Is it an aging population? Because the type of dentistry that you're going to be practicing, and certainly what's going to be happening in the next 10, 15, 20 years, is very much related to the demographic, to where you are, the suburb you are, and the type of people that are actually in that suburb. Now, if you sort of think about the aging population and that the bell curve is going to be, I think they sort of said that more than 50% of your patients are likely to be over 65 by the year 2036. Now, what does that mean for you? And you think about the type of practice that you've got now and the type of practice you probably have in 10 years or 20 years. Now, what we're also seeing is DMFT rates, the decayed, missing and filled teeth rates, have dropped markedly. I remember when I graduated, in the practice that I bought, we had about, as far as the ratio of dentists to patients concerned in the country, we had about 3,000 patients if we divided the number of dentists into the population, with a DMFT of around about 12 of a 30-year-old. Now, what's happened today is we sort of see with an oversupply of dentists, all of a sudden most practices are lucky to have 1,000 to 1,200 patients, and they have a DMFT at the same age of about 6. So we've seen the number of patients shrink significantly, and the number of decayed, missing and filled teeth have shrunk significantly. So what has actually happened? So if we had 3,000 patients and they had a DMFT of 12, we had 36,000 surfaces basically to work on. Now you've got 1,000, maybe 1,500 patients times 6 is 9,000. So you've gone from 36,000 down to 9,000. Why has that actually happened? Purely and simply, fluoride is dental education better? Yeah, probably is. Is oral hygiene better? I don't necessarily think so. The kids we see in our practice, do they brush their teeth any better than the kids did 20, 30 years ago? Maybe, maybe not. I obviously think that the fluoride has had a significant impact. What about prices? How do prices relate to salaries? What's actually happened to the charges? Is that something that's affected the demand for dental services? How much did you charge for a porcelain fused to metal crown in 2012 or 2008 or 2000? Now, we did an interesting study. We compared the prices of BMWs, of housing prices, of school fees, and PFM crowns. And we wanted to see what the rate of change has been in the last 20 years. which was the only one, relatively speaking, that went backwards. Now, you guessed it. Unfortunately, it was the crowns. And this cause is a big issue. So in real terms, as far as inflation is concerned, and our costs of running our practices, we're actually going backwards. So we've got more competition. We've got less DMFT. And we've also got our prices going backwards. Not so great. Educational attainment of our patients, is that going to affect the type of patients here, the type of work? I think absolutely. The consumer expectations, do you have an aesthetically biased group of people? Do you have somebody who's interested? Well, what are they interested in? Can you sell a high-end aesthetic treatments in certain places and certain practices? So obviously that's a significant factor. Innovation that you offer in your own practice, innovation in the dental sector overall, that also is going to affect demand. Are people making products that you actually, the consumers and your patients actually want? Dental insurance, well, that was a big issue. We talked about this. We sort of think that's a big factor as well in private practices. I mean, even here in Sydney and Double Bay, we are getting people come into our practice and they're actually suggesting. I did, even last week, I saw two patients. I did two surface composites on two patients, and both of them had an expectation that I should be charging the fund only. That really was, and I'm hearing this story across the country. There's expectation now of basically a no gaps type scenario. The government investments are obviously another huge factor. The CDDS was something that drove demand very, very strongly for a long period of time. And of course, a lot of the dentists unfortunately went to town and sort of did the wrong thing and really overspent the budget. That's something I think we have to be very careful of. Depending on which political party sort of comes in, but that's something we need to watch. So lots of factors, but I think the two most significant factors, the DMFT, the population, and the third one are the prices. These are very, very significant factors as to where we're heading. So even if we sort of make a suggestion that demand actually stays static, so we go really back to the previous sort of slide here. Let me just go back for a second. We say rather than here, let's sort of say the demand stays there. So where that is, that's a positive scenario. I don't think that's for traditional dentistry. Please remember what I'm saying, traditional dentistry, restorative, basic preventive elements, and some aesthetic treatments. So let's sort of say the demand stays static. Now, what happens about supply? So if we sort of look back to, say, 2010, where S1 is, that's the supply of dentists. That's the number of dentists in the country. Now, we saw a significant increase in the number of dentists. When the floodgates were open, we had a lot of overseas graduates come in, which was interesting. I certainly have no problem with overseas graduates, but unfortunately, I think the floodgates were open after ARCPO. That's the Australian Research Centre for the Population and Oral Health, looked at the number of dentists that they thought we would need by 2015. I think they got it seriously wrong. And they said they made it on the judgment that every patient would attend the dentist twice per year. Well, that doesn't prove to be correct. So what actually happened is we opened all these new dental schools. We let a lot of more dentists in, and so supply from about 2008 with the new schools and the scheme went from S1 to S2. So we've got more dentists around than we've ever had before. Now, has that actually changed? Are any of the dental schools closing? Are any of the dental schools controlling the numbers that are actually they're running through? Well, they can't afford to. They need the revenue. So what's actually happening is this graph is moving from S1 to S2, further down to this red line, further increase 2017. We're talking about 800 or 900 dentists now either graduating or coming into the country or passing exams each year now. So we're looking at a oversupply. Now, again, if we go back to our simple supply and demand curve, so demand at D1, remember we said that remains static, if it remains static. And S1, the supply goes from S1 to to S2, further to the right, what actually happens to equilibrium? You could sort of see what happens. P1, P2, that's where we're probably at. And what actually happens if it moves down, further down to S3 on the same demand? You could sort of see that obviously the quantity is increased, but the prices are going to be dragged down. Now, is there anything that we can do about that? I hope I haven't got any of you feeling sort of too depressed, but this is real. I mean, the likelihood is of that some dentists might be driving taxis in a few years. I used to laugh at that with the lawyers. But my concern is if things don't change in a hurry, we can't really change supply. We can't close the dental schools down. We can restrict perhaps some of the offshore imports coming in, which that's a little bit perhaps we could do that. But nevertheless, the government, I think, in a way, are quite happy that the supply is increasing because the prices are only going to go downwards. Now, let's extrapolate a little bit further. So what I'm talking about here is this growth is predicted between 0.5% to 1.5% per annum till 2020. So let's sort of say be positive, and even if it's a positive growth, so it doesn't go from D1 to D2, but there is a chance that it could. If demand goes backwards for traditional services, and if you look on the graph here, the supply moves from S1 to S2. So then all of a sudden, between S2 and D2, this is the new equilibrium point. Now, what happens to the prices? Now, I'm predicting that we could have a surplus of dentists of about 1,500 dentists by the year 2020. A lot of people that I'm talking to suggest that now that when they put advertisements in for various jobs, even in rural places, they're getting 30, 40 applicants. In the city, somebody told me the other day they had 87 applicants for one part-time job in the outer western suburbs. Now, that dentist, of course, could choose the best one, but he could also negotiate very strongly as far as the wages were concerned. So we're talking about hearing dentists now 27, 30% of revenue and paying their own lab bills. So we are in some trouble here. So what the problem I'm saying here, when supply increases from S1 to S2 and demand is negative or static, I said the dental Armageddon has arrived. That's really quite scary. Okay, so what are the implications? Increased competition. Lower fees, lower income to the dentists. Now, if you have lower income and you're going to get less per procedure, how much time are you going to spend on each one? So less time per procedure, you're going to be more aggressive with the way you do things. And what happens to the quality? Now, we've been very proud of the quality we've had in dentistry in Australia, but my fear is if things keep on going in this direction, we're going to have a lot of people doing some restorations in a mighty rush, and the quality is going to nosedive significantly. This is really, as I said, not what we signed up for. The other thing which is interesting is that we're seeing a big change in the dentists that are coming into dental school, the students coming into dental school, and there's more and more females now. It's becoming a female-centric profession. Certainly when I went through, and I'm in this bracket here, there were plenty of females, but it was still very male-dominated. What happened is here we're sort of seeing significantly the young dentists, more and more young females are coming into the profession. Now that's great. I think the women dentists, I personally think generally speaking, women's touch and feel and aesthetic abilities are, you know, a lot of times actually far superior to, you know, to us males. And certainly in the days we're not doing any aggressive oral surgery and having to pull teeth out and fight with third molars and broken six-year-old molars, I think women are well suited for the profession. The only problem is that we do see women coming in and out of the profession. So they come in, they might practice for a while, then they might go and have some children, work part-time, which is fine. But that actually means that the opportunity for males, then I think the younger males is actually could be very, very positive. So it's just an interesting change of the demograph as far as dentists are concerned, and it will be interesting to watch in the next few years what actually impact that actually has on dental practice. Now, this is another interesting graph as well, the changing nature of the patient cohort. and stop and think about the sort of proportion of people and the age of the people that you may be treating. We're talking about here, Australia's population continues to become top heavy. Life expectancy is increasing, and polypharmacy and its onerous side effects with dry mouth syndrome, et cetera, it means that here, a lot of the Australian citizens, this is going up higher and higher and higher. It equates to the changes in type of dentistry that you'll be performing, as one in five will be geriatrics within 15 years. If you've got a practice that is rich in people over 50, 55, I think you're in good shape. But I think what I'm alluding to, and I'm going to be talking a lot more detail about at Marketing Dentistry, is about making sure that you're in a practice or you're buying a practice, or that your skill set is very much in relation to the type of patients that you'll be treating and you'll be seeing. It's no good being able to produce high-end aesthetic work for over 55-year-olds if your practice is full of children. You're just barking up the wrong tree. So skill set has got to be related to where you're practicing. That is really, really important. But we'll talk more about that at the Marketing Dentistry program. So what am I going to be doing in general practice? If you're trying to extrapolate through in the next 5 years, next 10 years, next 15 years, where do we see this heading? And do you have the skill set to be able to deliver this? Is it going to be increase in aesthetic dentistry? I think so. I certainly think in some areas there will be. It won't be across the board, but I certainly think that's something that you actually have to master. The interesting thing is the government talk about scope of practice. What am I actually allowed to do? What was I taught as an undergrad? Were you taught ceramic veneers? Were you taught composite veneers? It might have been in the list of scope of practice, but how much practice did you actually have? I think oral medicine is one that's going to change significantly. The polypharmacy, all the things that we talked about, diagnosis of systemic conditions. I think that that's from the oral environment. I've got no doubt that that's going to increase significantly well as technology changes. Orthodontics is one obviously I'm very, very passionate about, and why we've actually delved into writing a course specifically for GPs in aesthetic orthodontics, which is a new realm of orthodontics, which the traditional orthodontists don't really comprehend what we're actually teaching here. But I believe there's going to be a very, very, very strong demand. And in relation to clear aligner therapy in particular, we noticed the integration. In fact, we're doing some trials on integration of aesthetics and orthodontics with sequential aligners. And I know that the technology is right on our doorstep, so that I've been able to predict far more than just tooth movement. Hence, that's why with at the Postgrad School of Dentistry, we've written courses on aesthetic orthodontics and on oral medicine, designed specifically for general dentists who obviously want to stay as general dentists, but they want to broaden their skill set. We see these two as very, very interesting parts of the future. Endodontics, you're going to go and do a master's in endodontics? I don't think so. I think you'd be a brave person to go and invest in a microscope and do endodontics. But nevertheless, there are some people who are very interested in that, and it may end up being a niche market that nobody else is in that perhaps is worth looking at. Oral surgery, not classical so much oral surgery that we, but more about the implants. Obviously, that's something that's very, very important for you to be able to do. And the periodontics and preventive perspective, I don't think a lot of general dentists will end up doing much of this. Obviously, be passing this on to a third party in your practice at some stage here as well. Although with an oversupply of dentists, perhaps this may be sort of something that sort of becomes more popular again, and people will be forced to do. So what's likely to happen? So this has been the traditional life of a dentist: the early struggle, the fun, the white water when things get maybe 30, 35, when sort of life becomes a little bit trickier. Predictable success, let's sort of say between 32 and 52, to 32 to 60 perhaps. Then the chances of getting on a treadmill, it gets a bit boring, gets predictable. The big rat, and then the death rattle. Is this still likely to happen for most people? I think to some extent, yes. A lot of the events obviously surround what happens with you're affected by your family, but the career paths of dentists often taken a very common path. So what we look at here is, we'll just go back to this here, this slide here. So what actually happens is the Genesis, this is just breaking down your career, the way we're see things heading at the moment. So what actually happens, Genesis, you start off, this is where the whole game sort of starts. You graduate, that's great. What do? You get your first job. Hopefully you get some good experience. And then you come to the age of nearly 30s, you look at buying a practice. Is that something, buying into a practice, is something so critical now that you get right? Again, we'll be talking a lot about buying, what type of practice you should be buying and where you should be looking, and is it suited to you at the Marketing Dentistry series in August. Then you hit the GFC, the great financial crisis, the great family crisis. What actually happens, you get married, have a couple of kids, you get a mortgage, and the drama sort of starts. It's very difficult for young people now to get ahead. We know this, we're looking at this, is something sort of with my children, I'm sort of grappling with this all the time now, how difficult it is for them to get a start, especially in Sydney and especially in Melbourne. Sydney in particular, it's very, very difficult. Now with the changes in the superannuations, as far as buying your practice and running your owning your practice in your super fund, that's also going to be more difficult, owning the practice premises rather. So that's a little bit more difficult. The good thing is, what you should be doing is then when you get into this age, in your 40s, if you possibly can, discard the dangers. Don't do any procedures that you can get yourself into trouble. Get yourself into areas that you feel really, really comfortable about. Now, a lot of dentists then in their late 40s hit the wall. This is a term used in marathon runners where basically you just can't go anymore. It gets boring. You don't want to go to work. You know when you've hit the wall, when your patient rings up and cancels and you smile. Now, you know, that might sort of sound funny. When I was a young dentist, if somebody didn't turn up, I would be irate. Perhaps when I got into my 35 to 40, I would be a little more circumspect and I'd have other things to do. I guess when you get into your 50s, what actually happens is when somebody cancels, you think, great. Now, that's when you know you need to have a bit some reinvigoration occurring. The idea is to then go into a subspecialty or an area where you remain in general practice, but you know a lot more of. And that's certainly something that I did with sort of clear aligner therapy and aesthetic orthodontics probably 10 years ago now. That was one of the best things that I could have gotten into. And the end game and exit strategy, well, that's something that, again, needs to be talked about very, very carefully. And we'll look at those a little more closely sort of in August. So where do you go from here? How far ahead can you plan? And how far ahead can you anticipate? How do you think dentistry is going to look in 2025 and even further 25 years from now in 2040? If I look back and I think, if I graduated in 1978 as a very young man, and I think to myself, here we are 38 years later, how does dental practice look between from then to now? How is it likely, if I put another 38 years, what's likely to happen? Can you necessarily anticipate anything that's going to happen? What can I offer my patients? Do you have a sustainable competitive advantage? And where are those patients who want those services? These are some of the huge challenges. How far ahead do you think you can plan? It's a very, very difficult question. It depends very much on the individual. But these are the questions that you really must be asking yourself. And if you can answer them, and you know the and you've got something a great plan for the future, you say, in 2025, my practice is going to look just like this. I'm going to be doing this, I'm going to be doing that, et cetera, et cetera. And you've got the skill set to deliver, that's fantastic. If you don't keep on changing your skill set, though, I believe you're going to be in significant trouble. So please ask yourself those questions. Where do you think it's all heading in the next, certainly 5 to 10 years? And will you be prepared for it? Are you prepared to reinvest as far as time, money, education's concerned? These are all very, very significant questions. And again, what I'm coming back to, are the patients with that skill set likely to be in the area that you're practicing? I see so many times people investing so much money in technology, in cone beams, in all sorts of sophisticated machinery that they just underutilize. That's really, really not good at all. Try and think the thing through. Now, this is an interesting picture. This is a molar life cycle born pre-1970. You can see the occlusal, the two service, the MOD with a broken cusp, the crown, then the implant, then the forceps. Is this likely to happen? If you look at your patients now of the age of, say, 30 to 35, what stage are they up to? When I was a young dentist, I would see many, many patients come in and you'd see them with MOD amalgams. And you know that amalgam is going to keep on expanding. You know they're going to break a cusp off. You know this is going to happen. So you know that a lot of this is actually happening. What happens today? You get a 30, 35-year-old in, and what do you see? You'll see this, and you might see an occlusal lesion. How many times do you take bite wings on a mouth that's not particularly clean, and yet do you see any interproximal caries? No. So I think you're going to be practicing more in this realm, and you might get broken cusps. Certainly for younger patients, but I don't think you'll be doing as much of this as you will of that. Now, the dentists need to do that. Can therapists do that? The answer probably is yes. So what does that mean? These are your chief modes of income, and a lot of these are going to be disappearing. So if you've got a lot of patients who are in the right-hand realm, the MODs, the cusps, the crowns, and the implants, that's great. If you've got a lot of patients in this left-hand realm, you're potentially in trouble. Have a good look. Have a look at the end of the week and just go back and look at the actual, just do one simple little exercise by putting the average age of your patient from everybody you saw this week and see if you can see a correlation between the income that was derived by certain groups. Go under 20, go 20 to 40, 40 to 60 and over 60 and just do that little exercise for yourself. I think you'll be quite surprised. So dentists in the 21st century, our roles are now not only to maintain and restore the dentitions, but to comprehend and to create and more often to augment beauty. I'm a firm believer that we certainly, again, the oral health and oral medicine are going to be two areas of practice, and all sorts of aesthetic treatments, whatever they are, whether they're facial, perioral or interdental, I think this is where practice is heading. The question is, will you have the skill set and will you have the patience? And finally, am I ready to change? You've got to be candid with yourself. I speak to so many dentists who sort of say, no, I'm fine. The cold, hard reality is you're not fine. Our prices are not going up. We've got more demand, higher demand than ever. We've got health funds are putting significant pressure on practices. There's no question, Bupa, 120 practices so far. What happens when they've got plenty of cash, they want to buy more and more and more and more. It's not going to make it easier. It's going to make it more and more difficult. Recognizing the right practice for you, that is imperative. Recognize your weaknesses, please. Look yourself in the mirror and sort of say, what am I good at? What am I not so good at? And be honest and then supplement wherever your weaknesses are. Go and do some more study, get a better skill set, or if not, get somebody else who can plug those weaknesses. Build a practice, for instance, where you bring in an orthodontist, bring in an oral surgeon. It might only be a GP, but bring people into your practices. Recognize your weakness. Speak to somebody. Seek a mentor. I was very fortunate when I was involved in the Entrepreneur of the Year program back in 2011, and my mentor was Jack Cowan from Hungry Jack's. And he spent a lot of time with me, and he was telling me about, I need a crisis. He said, the best thing that can happen to you is a crisis. He said, every 2 years you have to fall off your perch. I was shocked. He said, that's the only way you're going to continue to innovate. Now, the greatest time of innovation is always in a crisis, like during the World Wars. Things happen fast. You've got to get off your butts and do stuff. Obviously, CE and CPD, new skill sets we talked about. And finally, competitive advantage is the key. You've got to be able to do something that everybody else can't do. And if possible, you've got to find something that's sustainable that somebody else for a long time can't do. That's also very, very important. I'm going to be talking a lot more about this and certainly how it relates within modern day practice and demographics. Just to look at practices, in August, we're going to break down Australia into lots of different zones and say, okay, let's sort of see if you've got the skill set that actually matches the demographic, the geographical graph, and sort of see if this actually makes any sense. And this is an exercise you must do before you enter into a practice, even as a job, or even if you're going to buy a practice. You should look at this very, very carefully. So thank you for listening. We've been talking for half an hour now. Please, if any of you have any questions, Let's see, Clive, do you think oral cancer screening is something we should incorporate into others? Thanks, Clive. Yeah, the answer is definitely. There's a gentleman in Singapore, the University of Singapore, have come up with a really interesting device, which I saw recently. It's actually plugs into your onto the iPhone. I think it's the Apple 6 Plus, and it actually casts a blue light into the oral mucosa. So it was really, really quite amazing. So yeah, do I think you should be doing it? The answer is definitely yes. Swabs, yes. Salivary tests, yes. Breath tests, yes. I think absolutely. The question is that something that you've got a skill set for currently? In our oral medicine, the grad diploma of oral medicine, that Dr. Michael Stubbs is the specialist in oral medicine, he's running, he certainly incorporates that into that particular course. So that's sort of something that you may sort of want to sort of consider. It's a tremendous course, and I think for something that GPs should be doing. Very, very important. Okay, anybody else with some questions? The question is, are there any CPD points at the marketing dentistry? I believe so. I think that for every hour that you actually attend, I think it's 1 point for every hour. So if you're on board for a couple of days, I think you could probably get up to 16 points, which are pretty sort of invaluable. Given that you only need 60 points every 3 years. That still is something, as far as I'm concerned, which is let's just sort of say that the structure of the CPD program at the moment, I think really needs to be looked at very, very carefully, because people are getting points willy-nilly for all sorts of things. I know that the sort of the self-policing type of scenario that we have is still existing, but that concerns me. I know that the government just don't have the resources to be able to sort of to monitor a program like this. And certainly if the Liberal Party, they're trying to save money in dentistry, I can't sort of see that happening, changing any time fast. I'm just having a look at here at the people who have come on. Are there any dentists sort of outside of in any rural areas? Can you just write any of you here from any rural areas? I see Ben Feng. Hi, Ben. Karen, so thanks, Karen. So, how are things up in Cairns at the moment? I'd imagine, is that becoming more competitive as well? Karen's just answering. Clive's up in Noosa. Tight now with the general dental school at JCU. Yeah, I mean, that was a really interesting investment, the government. I think I've had the pleasure of actually teaching some of the students who've graduated from JCU, quite a variation in the standard. Actually, I'm seeing this sort of quite across the board. We've sort of got in our programs now about 35 dentists now enrolled in the aesthetic ortho program, and I'm seeing all sorts of interesting sort of variations in standards. I said, as far as JCU is concerned, Karen, are they how do they go? So sort of, do they actually treat private patients there? Because this is obviously a huge issue. Yeah, they are. Okay, well that's a concern. And what about, are they doing complex restorative dentistry, any aesthetic dentistry? It's It's an unbelievable facility. Actually, I gave some lectures there a few years ago. I was really amazed at the. Okay, so Karen's come back and said, "Yes, some." Okay, that's interesting. Well, I mean, that's. I mean, I guess that's good and that's bad. I mean, how do they pay the students, or sort of, or do they? I'm interested to know how, actually how that works. I think I remember that the students told me that they actually have to pay the lab bill, and that's about it, which is sort of quite interesting. And I wonder how many dentists are actually. Is there anybody else from anybody else sort of outside of Sydney? And I'd like to be any comments on people suggesting, are we actually sort of seeing, are you sort of seeing some of the things we talked about? Are you sort of seeing more price competition? Are you sort of seeing a flight towards insurance fees only? I'm interested sort of to know what your thoughts are on that and how the funds are affecting your areas. So that now we've got a comment here that says Bupa have been telemarketing my clients, telling them they should be going to their practice. Has anybody else had the same thing happening? I mean, that's quite sort of scary. It really is a problem. So I kind of sort of says agree, Graham. Thank you. You sort of said yes. So obviously, sort of seeing the same things happening. So if we're getting, if we're actually getting, so what's actually happening to your fees? Are people shopping around more? Are they comparing it to the funds? And Groupon offers, yeah, that's not so good. I don't know if that's sort of something which is too wonderful for the quality. I mean, we saw all sorts of things. We saw it, for instance, in Invisalign, that a dentist in Sydney was offering $3,500 for Invisalign 4 cases. And two crowns for $995. I mean, that's pretty sort of scary. The fact that we were charging $1,500 for crowns back in the 90s, and now we're charging $1,800, it's almost like 20 years later. Almost nothing's happened. Thank God the lab bills haven't gone up. But I guess I've had sort of some impact on that, so I won't go down that sort of track. But you can imagine the old days when I first graduated, the crowns, the PFM crown was $250. That was like 30 years ago. So things it's really, really quite remarkable sort of how things have changed. What about subspecialties? Any of your thoughts on subspecialties? Oh, yeah, often shopping on x-ray fee. Yeah, I can't tell you how many patients we've had recently have come and they said, I went for my checkup at HCF, I had my teeth cleaned, I had some fluoride put in, I had some x-rays done because it was all free through HCF, and then now I'm coming to you because I actually need the complex work done. I find that just incredible. So how do you know what to do? You're not allowed to do an exam again. I mean, it's just really strange. Really, really, really strange. When Bupa sort of bought a dental corporation, they sort of claimed that they weren't going to be having any of these preferred provider options. I just don't think that's actually happened. You can sort of see, you know, as Clive has sort of said, we're getting more and more of this and it's going to be a bigger push. Yeah, so it's only relatively small, but they've got plenty of money. Money's cheap. The banks are very delighted to lend these guys lots and lots of money. It's a vertically integrated model. If you're controlling the insurance and you're controlling everything else that's going on, and the prices and the fund and the actual clinics themselves, you're in a very, very strong position. I think what Bupa made $323 million last year. I was just checking on their website last night. So they're doing okay. I think that's just surviving on $320 million now. Okay, Clive said we've introduced injectables recently and it's been very popular. Using an experienced RN, and although we only do it on a Friday, she's booked up about 4 weeks in advance. Wow, that's interesting. Well, Clive, that's interesting because I sort of, again, a very strong advocate. I certainly do think that this is very, very important for dentists to be able to do that sort of thing. I think the sort of the injectables, the whole facial experience of perioral sort of aesthetics. Again, we teach that in the aesthetic ortho course. Look at the whole face now. This is just not the face, and not just perioral. This is everywhere we're going. Christine, it's understood that only 30% of the population go to the dentist regularly. Do you think that if we work together and industry to raise engagement to even 60, many of these competitive issues would dissipate and GDPs can relax and do quality? Christian, I think the interesting thing is why only though do 30% of the population go to the dentist regularly? Do you think if we work together in the industry to raise and get to the 60%, that would be great? The question is, these 30-year-olds, and I'm just citing as examples a 30-year-old, if they went to the if the reason they're going less regularly is because there's not as much wrong with their teeth. If they go every 6 months and they find out that nothing much happens, it's a clean and scale and a bit of fluoride and nothing happens. And then they go next time, it's 9 months later and nothing happens. And then 12 months later, nothing happens. They think, well, do I actually have to go to the dentist as much as everybody says I should? And am I actually being over-serviced if I go twice a year? The old days, twice a year is important. I think it's very difficult to get somebody who's got no disease. If you're an athlete and you're running well and everything's going nice and you're not tearing muscles and things are and putting on loads of fat, are you going to change your behavior? I think there's going to be more of a need. I think if we could get 60%, that would be great, but we can't do it on traditional forms of dentistry. If you go along and say to patients, "Listen, I can do an oral health status check through, let's sort of say, saliva, through breath, through a swab, looking under your tongue, doing all sorts of things," and you can raise their awareness that we can look after your body holistically more through the oral environment and to make you pretty. I think pretty and healthy, systemically healthy, are the two big issues that we should be pointing at. Again, that's why we built the Postgrad School of Dentistry, and that's why we've aimed two postgrad courses and took us years to get these things through the government because I think that that's the area. Again, the pretty aesthetics, people will be dragged there. Again, as Clive sort of said, the injectables, I think, very, very important. And all the oral health stuff, the sleep apnea, the polypharmacy. I think that they're the things that we can get. So could we get them 60%? I think maybe we could get 45, 50%, but again, it's the skill set that we've got and what we're offering to our cohort that's got to change sort of significantly. I think that's a really, really relevant point. The issue is just coming back to Clive about the injectables. Clive, what's your sort of so there's is there any are you competing on so efficacy? How actually you're presenting this to your patients, given that there are a lot of people doing injectables now, and there'll be doctors and plastic surgeons around? Are you saying that we that we're a better place to do it, or are we that our girls more experienced, or our price is better? Or I'm quite intrigued to know what your form of competitive advantage is, given that there are quite a few people out there. Availability of Botox, and there's still this gray area. I mean, I know that the ADA have been looking at this, but there's a gray areas. Look, I think it's very interesting. I'd like to sort of to know your point of view. So, all right. What else? Any other questions we've got here? All right, Clive's just writing one other one. Sorry, I just missed one that was about Sarah here. I'm sorry, I didn't see it. Here we go. Sorry, where is it? Arcana, yeah. Sorry, Arcana, we're just having a look here. About, can you just ask that question again, Arcana, if you possibly could? Oh, here we go. Could you please provide an input on incorporating CereLink into practice? If yes, market this area. Arcana, look, I obviously was involved in the lab industry for a long time. I did a lot of postgraduate work sort of in prosthodontics as well. And that's how I got into the lab business through University of Hong Kong. And I, you know, I've been involved in Crown & Bridge for a long, long, long time. I guess CEREC, it's not just CEREC anymore, but there are a couple of other sort of milling machines, et cetera, scanners and mills. Do I necessarily think it's cost effective? And if so, what about the quality and the quality of the finished product, and how cost effective is this? In my opinion, if you're the type of person who's a real technophile sort of and like to play with computers and like to play with files and things like that, you know, is this an area suited for you? And if you've got plenty of time, I think the answer is you can get some really nice results. I know it's very technique sensitive. Again, we play with scanners and the materials that you're using, they're getting better. I certainly think, though, that as far as this is just my opinion is concerned, that it's very, very hard to justify a CEREC machine unless you can do it very quickly and unless you get a big demand. Because I can't tell you in days from so many practices around the country that I visited that we actually saw CEREC machines just catching dust and sitting in the corner, because at the end of the day, I think a lot of people sort of thought that rather than doing an inlay or an onlay, that it's probably just easier to cut that extra cusp down, put a marginal around, and take an impression and send it to a lab and make it for that. Because now the crowns are 130, 140, 150 bucks. It's pretty hard to, and the time that you mess around, it's pretty hard to sort of, in my opinion, unless you've got a lot of people in your practice and you've got a lot of time to be able to justify this CEREC. But certainly for some people, I think it's great. I've got a few people I know who've done very well from it. But certainly in my hands, and I think the bulk of people that I sort of see, unless things have improved dramatically in the last 2 years, that was the last time that I played with when I saw a brand new, and I haven't seen anything probably in the last 18 months. So unless there's a big change. But the Australian dollar, the way that it is, no, they're not going to be getting any cheaper. The scans, are they deadly accurate? I think they're reasonably good. Is the material fantastic? It's okay. So yeah, be careful. I'm more than happy to talk to you about that one in detail if you want to come along to the marketing dentistry program. But I see just a number more sort of question coming on. Yeah, it's not bad. I just think that with scanners also, with intraoral scanners coming on board, if you can prepare a crown, make a temporary crown and do a scan very, very quickly and get it off to the lab, I think that's a very, very, very efficient way of working. And obviously one that I think is going to be incorporated in the future. But you actually being a technician, part-time technician, sitting there messing around with a CEREC machine, I'm not so convinced that's the best way to go. All right, let's have a look. Yeah. Yeah, Clive just mentioned that sort of the relationship between oral health and general health. I think coming back to what Christine sort of said, I certainly think it is it's very, very important for us to get out there if we possibly can and educate the population into sort of knowing that there is a relationship there. So how does that actually happen? Well, obviously, you know, we've got to be able to sort of, we've got the technology now. We certainly do the breath machines, the salivary things, the scanners, all of these things. I think they're fantastic. Gingival crevicular fluid. There's so many interesting things that we can offer to our patients now. It's become mainstream. Could be. But I guess as educators, and I think this is what I'm particularly interested in now and interested in the future, I think that the universities do have to undergo a paradigm shift and realize that the traditional forms of dentistry are just not relevant long term when we've got an oversupply of dentists. And this is the type of thing, while we've gone down to the track that we are, we're writing a grad diploma in innovation entrepreneurship at the moment, because we want dentists to be more innovative. I think it is very, very important that dentists can look at these things, and the universities have to innovate as well. And our school, this new school that we've opened, we're very passionate about that, about being able to ensure that that the students, the GPs, can have a skill set that meets the demands of the public For generations to come. Very, very hard though for us as for educational institutions to change. Certainly, given the accreditation processes that are certainly incumbent at the moment. That's from Graham. Thank you. That one about the social media. I certainly think that social media scares me. I think social media is good in some respects, but I certainly also think that it can be damaging. They've talked a lot about this. I talked to Phil Palmer at Prime Practice, and we talked a lot about if you have negative reviews and people say some nasty things about you, and that can do a lot of damage. I think on the other hand, you can dissipate loads of information very effectively. I think you need a website. I think I read in Harvard Business Review that they said, I think 65% of American citizens were making the choice of their healthcare practitioners based on web searches. Now that's pretty frightening. But I'd say everybody speaks to us, I Googled it. And it's like you see WebMD and they make their own diagnosis. So I think you do have to have a presence, but I think I would be very careful with the social media. Instagram is one of my kids play with all the time, and my son's got 8,000 followers on Instagram. What it actually equates to, I don't know. People come up to him in the street and say, I know you from Instagram. Is that a good thing? Imagine you're walking down the street and somebody says, Graham, I know you because you're a dentist, and I know on the weekend that you played tennis with your mates or something. I don't know, is that a good thing or not? I just think you have to control it and you have to be very careful about the way you go about it. But I do think it's very powerful and something that certainly should be utilised in the future, but in a very, very controlled manner. We get a website and we get a bit of traffic through there. But we get some pretty crazy stuff too. We did a television show last year, and we certainly attracted a lot of patients, but not necessarily the types of patients that we always want. I'd say probably 10% of them were in the crazy mold. 10% we just really discarded, and we got some really other good ones. And just defining expectations and things, can be quite a frightening thing as well. Preference in scanners. The scanners for Crown and Bridge. Or there's a couple of things. There's scanners for ortho, scanners for ortho and Crown and Bridge. Or are you talking about scanners for oral cancer?
I'm going to ask that question.
For the scanner for.
Yeah. Just the general
preferences. Yeah, I certainly think I read an article for one of the US orthodontic magazines recently talking about scanners. It's really quite a lengthy discussion. I've got a if you can just maybe send through your email address and I can send you the article, because there's some really interesting things. Can we compare about 6 or 7 different scanners some interesting results. What's really interesting is that we found an impression material. I'm going to Germany in the next week to meet with these guys. It's a polyvinyl siloxane ether mix, which is actually more accurate than a scanner. So that's really, really interesting. I've been doing some clinical trials for these guys recently, and the results are really quite stunning. So that's worth having a look at. The Carestream one looks good. I've seen the Sirona scanner, I've seen the iTero scanner, I've seen the 3D, the three shape one, I've seen the iTero one. The iTero one is now being restructured again. The Element one is very good. But they all use different types of recording devices. So again, that would be something that would need a better discussion later down, and maybe we can talk about that if you guys want to come and visit us. If you want to come along to us, this thing, by the way, there's a code. If you go onto the marketing dentistry thing, there's a special offer. I think it's David Penn, all undercase 100. I think you'll see there is a special offer that you can get for a discount offer. So that's certainly worth having a look, because I think it's going to be a great event. And I'm more than happy to spend some time with any of you. Let me just confirm that. David Penn 100. So if you go to that discount code, marketingdentistry.com.au, that's certainly worth having a look at.
week is to talk to you, so he wants to open a second practice.
Okay, that'd be great. That'd be, yeah, more than happy to talk to any of you. Come along and we can talk about all the sort of ins and outs. But you've got to be very careful opening another practice. There's a lot to think about, and you've got to be really, really careful where you go, where you open these days. A lot of competition, and you can really make a big mess if you're not careful. Any others or any other?
I think
it's
that Burnett,
Missouri, and Grandmaster. Okay. But love to meet you all there. And yeah, we'll go over cups. And so Christine, yep. I can see some interesting things here that Christine's written. Oral systemic medicine links to fertility, aesthetics, yep. I think great, Christine.
Bernard McCary as well.
Just not getting this on here. Sorry, I'll just have a look at a couple more questions, which I'll try. What's the question?
So with a growing older population, do you think we should be placing more attention to removable prosthetics, both normal and the hybrid? If so, would it be worth considering bringing in a prosthesis as an addition to it?
The answer, that's from Graham?
Bernard.
Yeah, Bernard, the answer, yeah, definitely. I sort of, it's really interesting, when I go to Florida, I've sort of seen practices here which I would sort of call them almost circa 1980. This is where you've got a huge elderly population, a huge number of DMFT, and if you can bring a prosthetist in, you can offer a service with relines, with repairs, with dentures, with hybridized things. I think the answer definitely is yes. I think that's great. That's again, we're talking about what we're going to talk a lot about in August, about making sure that the skill set of your practice matches the cohort. That's really good. Do you have a preference in scanners? Yep, okay, can wait to you. Great. All right, look, thank you very much. We've gone over the hour, but really, thank you so much. If any of you like to come along later in the year, I'd really be happy to talk to you. And feel free to email me, pen@ip.net.au, or you can get me through the Postgraduate School of Dentistry. Lots of interesting things happening at the moment, it's a very challenging time. And if you're prepared, you'll be fine. But if you stick, be very, very careful, because it's a dangerous time. I'm really frightened for a lot of the young kids doing dental school at the moment, because I just don't know they're getting the skill set that they need to prepare for what the patients want in the next 10, 15, 20 years. So we all have to change, and we all have to get out and learn lots more. So thank you very much, everybody, and nice to talk to you. And we will, anytime you want to email me or even phone me, I'm always available. Thank you. Bye-bye.